Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Katherine Smith, who is a colleague of mine, a very good friend of mine, and likewise an academic sparring partner of mine, and we do have some quite heated conversations. Dr. Katherine A. Smith was born in the British Virgin Islands. She completed her doctorate in history at Howard University in 2009, and in 2012, had an article published entitled Economy, Politics, and the Early Formation of a Cultural Identity in British Virgin Islands Slave Society. Dr. Smith is a senior lecturer at the H. Laverty Stout Community College, attached to the Virgin Islands Studies Institute. She teaches a range of courses, including Virgin Islands history and Caribbean history, as well as teaching elementary social studies. She is also currently the president of the Association for the Preservation of Virgin Islands Heritage. One of Dr. Smith's preoccupations relates to cultural and national identity in the Virgin Islands. She's also interested in Virgin Islands social history, as well as the public interpretation and representation of Virgin Islands history through avenues such as historical sites and museums. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Dr. Katherine Smith, please.
Good morning. My presentation is entitled Complex Relationships, Stakeholders and the Processes of Recreating Heritage at the African Burial Ground, St. Philip's Anglican Church, Kingstown, Tortola. First, I will provide a brief historical background to the persons who were eventually settled in the village at Kingstown established by 1831. Then I'm going to provide a kind of a potted history of restoration work that has occurred at the site. I'll then speak a little bit about the role of stakeholders, and I will finish by commenting on the importance of values and heritage. According to Isaac Dukin, between August 1814 and February 1815, four ships, the Manuela, the Venus, the Candelaria, and the Atrevido, were intercepted and brought to Tortola. Well, the slave trade had been abolished by Britain, and the Navy was intercepting trading vessels traveling through the waters. These particular ships happened to be on their way to Cuba. Of the 1,318 who were brought to Tortola, 248 died of intestinal infection. They had been on the ships coming through the Middle Passage, leaving 1,070. Of these, 352 were assigned to His Majesty's Military and Naval Services, and 647 were indentured to various masters and mistresses throughout the territory. According to Dukin, the fate of 71 is unknown. The Abolition Act had further two orders in council that sort of regulated the treatment that was to be afforded to this population. Basically, they were not to be treated as enslaved people. They were to be apprenticed to masters and mistresses, as stated before, and sort of taught trades. They certainly were not supposed to be separated. That is, husband and wife and close relatives were not to be separated. Unless for employment purposes. And basically, these sort of indicated that the British government had a special responsibility in this group because they had been traveling through the waters after abolition. Executive authority had been vested in the collector of customs. Interestingly enough, by 1823, it was discovered that they were working in the fields. In 1823, there were 291 apprentices, 200 were indentured as domestics, 50 listed as laundresses, seamstresses, and cooks. It was found out that, in fact, they were engaged in cultivating grounds or working as herdsmen. In a letter dated 4th of August, 1821, Henry Clement, who was the acting collector at the time, referred to the unfortunate African apprentices, as they were called at the time. He referred to the deplorable state of the indentured lists, and in addition to this, indicated that a number of them had been going over to St. Thomas and St. John and working and coming back and remitting payment to the masters and mistresses. Others, masters, had left the island and nothing had been indicated in the indenture lists. Interestingly, he had also written a letter to the president of the Virgin Islands Council here at the time, Hetherington, informing Hetherington that he, Clement, had found that Hetherington's apprentices were, quote, dreadfully clothed, apparently badly fed, and bore strong evidence of repeated punishment. Quote, they were apprenticed to be taught a respective trade by their own account, and your admission to me that they have worked in your cane fields in common with your Negroes is absolutely illegal. In another instance, a planter, McLean, was responding to two statements by two African apprentices. These were two women, Betty and Amelia, and they had come forward and sort of made complaints that they had been receiving bad treatment and that they had been working in agriculture. Well, the response of McLean to these complaints was that, as a matter of fact, they were working in cotton fields, not sugar. That would be lighter work. And then, as a matter of fact, that he had punished them because he saw them as being liars. He had caught them in lies on certain occasions. But he had used the tamarind whip, which did not cut their skin. In fact, there was a petition from the Council and Assembly of the Virgin Islands in 1828, which asked for the British government, after the end of this indentureship period, to please remove these people from the Virgin Islands. They will form a distinct class of persons, for it does not appear that they will amalgamate either with free persons of color or with the slave population. With the former, no permanent connection has been formed, and very few instances with the latter. Furthermore, two commissioners' reports, Dugan and Moody, referred to the enmity between the slaves and the poor African apprentices, the daily exhibition of fights and quarrels in the streets, in which the poor African apprentices were opposed, and sometimes to the slaves, and sometimes to the free blacks, and colored people, as well as to the whites. So what's really going on in terms of understanding the history of these liberated Africans who became settled in the village of Kingstown and the Anglican church that was there, St. Phillips? There was competition over scarce resources. They were supposed to work in trades, and this was the territory of free blacks and whites. The economy was sort of fragile yet continuing in the early history in the Virgin Islands. There was a feeling of jealousy and envy on the part of the enslaved population. They just came here, and here they are, they're free, and they have the support, this special support of the British government. There was also a cultural conflict. It was noted that there was quite a bit of conflict, and in such conflict, there would be name calling. I'm not going to be specific about it, but it does indicate a feeling of great superiority on the part of the enslaved population and free blacks to these liberated Africans. It had to do with the fact that they were Igbo and Moko African, and that the Virgin Islands population had already established an identity. However, in 1823, when asked if they would want to be removed to Trinidad, only one agreed. At this point, by 1830, Robert Claxton was the collector and took it upon himself to actually request and write to the British government. He initially explained that whatever progress they had been making in the Virgin Islands, sort of their crops and whatnot were being destroyed by cattle and goats around the place, and already the conflict that they were experiencing was known. So he requested that the British government provide land and also £1,025 to establish what became the historic village of Kingstown. This village was established in 1831 and consisted of 110 acres. These acres, 1 acre each, these were allotted to the liberated island Africans in terms of the deeds remaining with the British Crown, but they had the use of them. In a letter dated 10th July 1831, there was a letter to the Governor Maxwell in the Leeward Islands. The African Frank has built a house there consisting of a hall and 2 bedrooms, all nicely shingled and presenting the appearance of neatness and comfort. Yet by 1832, Claxton was able to describe the character of the settlement. In fact, he described it as quite a separate town of itself, 4 miles distant from this, inhabited solely by Africans, without a single other subject resident amongst them who might have some influence over them. Other regulations were established. There was a supervisor appointed from amongst them and 6 constables. And another regulation was that if they did not use the land that they had been allotted, it would simply revert to the crown and be auctioned and provided to another who would use this land. Well, it has been reported that the liberated Africans eventually emigrated completely to St. Thomas. Dukin has stated that although the extent of this migration is not known, what began as a temporary measure to kind of supplement their wages became permanent. Greater research into this topic is needed. This group appeared to effectively form a community, perhaps related to the fact that they were mostly from 2 related ethnic groups, Moko and Igbo. Their experience had been harsh, but they had not experienced the full impact of legal slavery. The enslaved population in the Virgin Islands at this point had yet to be emancipated at the point of establishment of the village. Restoration work. I know that Dr. Turnbull, I see she's in the audience, author of Can These Stones Talk? St. Philip's Church Ruins at the Liberated African Settlement in Kingstown, has made calls for descendants of this population at Kingstown to come forward and has already identified key families. She has also noted that the initial plan was probably smaller and plainer. I'm speaking now about the church that was established in 1840, circa 1840, St. Philip's Anglican Church, within the historic village of Kingstown. It was probably smaller and plainer than the other rural churches in the diocese, but she states, while it was not the largest structure on the settlement, the chapel was perhaps the most prominent in its day. The materials used in the structure mirror the materials used in other ruins around the territory. You would be able to see here the same ballast brick, the same limestone and sand used as mortar. You would be able to see the same field rock, and you would be able to see the same use of coral in other structures of around the territory. The first attempt at restoration actually came in 1864, when a petition was sent by 64 of these liberated Africans to the Secretary of State for the colonies. They were asking for assistance to repair the chapel and protect the graves. Quote, this was the response of the Secretary of State, quote, and this is taken from Dr. Turnbull's work. I have to express my regret that I am unable to entertain this memorial. It appears to me that the liberated Africans ought, by their own labor, to be able to keep their chapel, which was built for them at public expense. Fast forward to the 1970s, as I have been told, there was Father Perigord here in the Virgin Islands at St. Paul's Anglican Church and in Sea Cows Bay. And he would hold, during the 70s, evensong monthly at St. Philip's Anglican Church. In addition, he ensured that vegetation was removed and that the site was cleaned, sort of the first step in restoration work. In 2000, the Millennium Committee was established. And there was discussion for actions such as bringing a West Indian, the typical West Indian home, to the site and using it as an interpretation center. It gained steam again between 2006 and 2007, and also considered ways of establishing this site as a heritage site in the Virgin Islands. Well, what did happen in about 2006 was that Dr. Kent, my colleague, worked with this group and the vestry at St. George's, and maybe the governor at the time, to actually shore up the structure, and you can see it right there, the stilts that were sort of placed to kind of hold it up, I think because of the building that was happening at the time across the road at Cedar School. In its last reiteration in 2013, the Millennium Committee received funding and the structure was stabilized. The stilts are no longer there, and there is a floor that was put in, and the windowsills also were sort of made to look whole. Different measures were taken to sort of restore the site, and it is stronger at the moment. In 2014, the Association for the President of Virgin Islands Heritage was established officially as a nonprofit group. I'm now going to speak about the African Burial Ground, which is the accompanying cemetery to St. Philip's Church. The group had met for 1 year as an ad hoc group and had been founded by Dr. Turnbull, and I see some of the members of the board here. I see the Elder Gil Trott, I see Ron Potter there as well. And the fact is that the concern and the initial restoration project of the group had to do with the burial ground and the accompanying cemetery to St. Philip's Church. In 2002, archaeological work had been conducted by the Caribbean Volunteer Expedition, which identified 44 graves. Furthermore, research by Dr. Turnbull has indicated the presence of at least 75 persons buried at St. Philip's Cemetery. Now, in 2014, when the group formed, it formed as a nonprofit. Last year, the group brought in a company from Bateman Civil Survey Limited out of St. Croix, which used ground-penetrating radar and identified existing graves. This technology identified over 30 graves. So what we see from all of that is that of the property that is still held by St. George's, the graves are not all included there. And in any interpretation, this would have to be explained. Understood that further up and going up behind into the hill, you would have found additional graves. So these graves were identified, and it was quite interesting, actually, to sort of watch this technology in play. Apparently, you can see where the soil has been disturbed, and I believe that the graves went as deep as 5 feet deep, and typically, well, there were a few that were 10 feet wide or 8 feet wide, you know, and so the interesting part is that we have the dimensions, and the persons who carried out this technology were also able to see down that the rocks lined at the side and that the bodies had been covered by sand. I think there were two children who were identified, and you can see this by the size of the graves on the site, and little pink flags were put to kind of indicate where each grave was found. So basically in its restoration bid, the APFI, the Association for the Preservation of Virgin Islands Heritage, started to work, establish a collaborative work with St. George's Anglican Church. And the first step was to enclose and sort of protect the site. I'm going to come back to the other slides. So the problem was that in the beginning, like before, how it had been before, persons would be walking over graves to go into the site. Taxis would drive in and be parking right over the graves. And there's this real need to respect the ancestors who are buried there. So this wall was constructed, and it is It's not an addition, it's an attempt to protect and enclose. Although we sort of used, as you can see, similar materials as were used in the, some of the similar materials that were used in the original structure, but this is a modern style of wall, and in the interpretation we certainly would speak about when this wall was constructed. This was phase one after the penetrating survey was carried out, radar survey was carried out. The next phase that we hope to enter into, because at the moment there is a new vestry and there's a new rector. And as recently as yesterday, there was a vestry meeting in which the management agreement that we've been working under, which is follows a conservation agreement which was provided in the National Parks Trust Act of 2006. It provides for nonprofit groups to work with landowners to restore and develop such sites. So they asked for these documents, the new vestry and the new rector, and we are just waiting to see whether we will move forward with what we would want to carry out next, which would be marking the graves, sort of leveling the ground in a way, marking the graves. Certainly providing a sort of a memorial that lists the names of each of the persons buried there, providing parking in terms of gravel. We've had a lot of discussions about how we would carry out these sort of steps. You know, you don't want to have too much, you certainly don't want any concrete or asphalt at the site. You don't want, though, too many stones, too much brick. You know, we've just had a lot of discussions about how we would carry out bringing back the sacred nature of the site and also establishing it as a heritage site. You can see a few of the other features. We understood that the culture that was there had these perfumed benches, Igbo. This is described in Equiano's narrative. And they would provide these specifically for visitors, and we want to include a couple of those logwood benches that would be done in a very natural way. There's a consideration of stone markers to be put down to put the names on rather than the memorial. So which one, what, how much can the site, you know, what can we put on the site without certainly overwhelming the site and keeping a, like a sort of rustic nature to the site and a booth at the entrance. The last phase that we would want to engage in would be the provision and interpretation center. At the moment, there is a structure on the site and residents live there. These residents are renting this structure from St. George's Church, and there has not been a decision on what might or might not happen in terms of this structure. But if there would be a decision, we'd certainly hope to have this interpretation center and have it done in such a way as to include, you know, the visual or, you know, audio, a children's room, and different things that we've talked about in the group. It is sometimes interesting to sort of compare restoration work that one is, you know, trying to attempt with other similar projects. And so the other project that it was very interesting for me to take a look at was the African Burial Ground in Manhattan. The African Burial Ground Monument in Manhattan. Interestingly enough, it took 20 years for the memorial to be constructed. So I found out from that these projects take time, and you know, there's a kind of a rhythm that goes along with it. And it took 20 years of activists, scholars, and elected officials. It was only when there was a plan to build a new federal building that an outcry started, a really public one. And in 1993, Howard University formed the ABG project and excavated the 419 graves that were found there, 24 feet below the street. By 1994, 150,000 people signed the petition to create the public memorial in 2006. And the exhibition space was opened in 2010. The interesting thing about this memorial and that relates to this restoration project at St. Phillips is the use of symbols. In Manhattan, there's a Sankofa symbol. And there are other symbols that have to do with West African religious burial practices, etc. And certainly, we have been debating the use of symbols in this burial ground at St. Phillips. We've been debating, some of us say, were they Anglicans? We think they were Igbo traditional. They practiced Igbo traditional religion. Which one was it? Obviously, they were Anglicans. They petitioned for the repair of their chapel. But to what extent did they also maintain their practices? Probably both, probably to a large extent. Probably they were both, and this is something we want to reflect in any restoration work on the project. In fact, we met late last year with a Nigerian community group here, mostly Igbos, and even though in the group we have done a lot of research in terms of these sorts of practices, they've agreed to work with us, and we just really need to make sure that whatever interpretation happens here, that it's very accurate to the population that was there. In terms of the monument in Manhattan, there are also things such as the 20-minute introductory film, which is a kind of a documentary, and it really discusses, it really shows you funeral rites at the time and the lives of those persons who were buried there. And as I spoke about the Interpretation Center before, it was interesting to see that because we spoke about all of those types of things going into our Interpretation Center if we were able to establish that. And the last thing that was very interesting to me about the monument in Manhattan was that they didn't have the names of the persons, so when they described the persons buried there, these were the descriptions: burial 75, newborn or stillborn baby. Burial 284, man between 22 and 28 years. And the kind of exciting thing about this project is that we have names. We have three different sets of names that just by sort of including them onto the burial ground, not really the Interpretation Center, perhaps in the same memorial, it kind of gives you a history of what happened. We actually have the names in the records of the original persons who came off of those four ships, African names. We have the names, Dr. Tortola has done research and has the names of the persons buried there, and then there are also the names of the petitioners to the Secretary of State. So just by naming and looking at those names, and you know, it's just a very interesting thing, and if we were able to commemorate them in this way, because the graves are totally unmarked at the moment, that would be a real accomplishment in terms of this project. I'll speak a little bit about the role of stakeholders. There are many stakeholders to this particular project. I feel like the previous restoration group was a stakeholder milling committee. Association of Preservation of Virgin Islands Heritage would be a stakeholder. The BVI Tourist Board is a stakeholder. They do check in periodically on the progress they hope to see at this site. The Ministry of Education and Culture would be a stakeholder in terms of bringing through children to just have it in a very dynamic way involved in the teaching of history here. The wider community in the Virgin Islands, certainly a stakeholder in terms of the importance of this history to them. And most importantly, St. George's Anglican Church. In another attempt to compare, I looked at what happened with St. Paul's Methodist Church in Dallas, Texas. And just to really put it in a brief way, by 1970, St. Paul had been a part of a community of freed black landowners in the US immediately after emancipation. But by the 1970s, this community had disappeared. There was highway construction and urban decay. Now, the city of Dallas and Dallas Museum of Art decided to gentrify the district, bring in commercial and residential properties, and especially establish the area as a public arts district. Well, what did the church do? And this is the interesting part. The church immediately, or very quickly, worked on securing Dallas Historic Landmark status as a direct response to what was going on. And so by the time the plan for the district was presented, the church had already been designated to status 5 months before. In addition to that, the church decided to start branding itself as an arts church, specifically the soul of the arts district, offering Tuesday night jazz programs and doing collaborative performances with Dallas Black Dance Theater. In addition to that, doing that, the church also agreed when the University of Texas at Austin asked to carry out archaeological work at its site. And in doing so, it also participated in the oral history interviews and kind of gave a sort of colored, nuanced history to the history of the community as well as the church. So what I'm looking at is the fact that the church became very active and took certain measures in terms of what was going on in the environment. And I believe this has a parallel to what is happening in the British Virgin Islands. I kind of look at the Dallas local government's attempt to, well, intention, to establish this as an arts district as the importance of heritage tourism that is being spoken about in the BVI right now. So I think that in a similar way as this church sort of took advantage of the arts district, we definitely would want St. George's Church to also sort of just step right in there and take advantage of the economic circumstance, which would be heritage tourism and carrying ahead with a restoration project such as this. In addition to that, there is an archaeologist who's coming in the summer and he's been asking for maybe 1 or 2 years, can he excavate the property to the right of where the cemetery is? And I feel that if permission was given for that in the way that St. Paul's granted permission, that this would also forward, you know, the development of the restoration at the church and also have the church as stakeholders really participate in how things move forward. Last of all, I'm just going to make a few comments on the importance of values in heritage. I was reading an interesting article that described heritage sites as anything that embody anything that is valued as heritage. This could be a song, an oral tradition, a heritage site. That was an interesting description for me. And it really brought out the importance of the fact that the importance is the reason that the heritage site was established, the values and the practices that it was meant to embody, the messages, as it's been stated, that were meant to be transmitted, right? So you would have different stakeholders. This site at Kingstown, the St. Phillips, you would have different persons who receive any sort of restoration work there differently. Anglicans would feel differently from persons who are Afrocentric and very much into that sort of cultural heritage, Methodists, because they were originally baptized as Methodists. So the important thing here is that it really became really clear to me that the work on heritage sites would be important, but the meaning behind the site, the values and the reasons for which it was actually there in the first place, these are particularly important. And so when I look at it this way, and you can use UNESCO's definition of intangible heritage, which would have to do with, you know, sort of the culture and all of the values and all of the, you know, the actions and that are carried out in heritage sites. And we would sort of want to remember that this would be provide the real meaning for restoration. And so as we look at St. Philip's Church in Kingstown, this is why APFI also included the provision of a performance center. Why not include some of the activities that were carried out at this church, such as the wakes, such as harvest, such as weddings? This is also why Father Perigord, I believe, conducted Evensong regularly, and Father Branch consistently and annually used it for the annual Emancipation Sunrise service. And these were all important to sort of aid in what we can call continuing or recreating heritage at these sites. I'll finish with my call to action, which is that the places are important. Honorable Walwyn mentioned Main Street. How does the population feel about the capital city? Do we know what happened there? Who were the families that lived there? What does that city mean to us? What are we going to do about Old Main Street? What about the ruins at Bruce Bay? Do we know how it connects to the outstanding conspiracy or rebellion that happened there, revolutionary in intent, the social history that comes out of this area and all that it tells us about the production of sugar on this island of Tortola? So that my call to action is the same call that I believe most people would make here today, which is that we, you know, definitely work together and we try to forward restoration of these projects as best as possible. Thank you.